nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 3.3. Now we're going to talk about implementing finite difference time domain. Before, we already covered it in one dimension. Now we're extending it to 3D. And we already said that we want a Yee lattice in which we have E fields and H fields all staggered by half a grid point in order to get the maximum accuracy in our solutions. And so again, this is the lattice on the upper right-hand side. And you see E fields are on the edges, H fields are on the faces. And then we want to solve Faraday's law in 3D. So you can actually discretize and then write this out as a function of each component. And so, of course, just explicitly writing out curl of H and then matching that up with the H components, right? So it gives you basically these three equations. And so, of course, if you don't remember that, you could look at Griffith's textbook on electrodynamics. And then if you discretize all this on the Yee lattice, then you get something like this, where you have an update equation for H, which depends, of course, on the old H value, times two terms that are differences of E components that are orthogonal to that H component. So basically the difference of the Y components and the Z components for the HX field. And of course the Y and Z components follow a similar form, where the Y component depends on the difference in EX and EZ, and then the Z component of H depends on difference of EX and EY. So then, of course, we can perform the same procedure on Ampere's law. And so in Ampere's law, of course, it looks something like this with Maxwell's correction. And then you basically get an update equation for E, where the new E at a certain time, q plus one, would be equal to the original E at time q, plus the difference of H fields in the Z direction and the Y direction. And so again, just like we had before, they're always like orthogonal. And this comes just from the nature of the vector equations. These are all curl equations. So of course it makes sense that they're orthogonal. So for EX, we have delta HY and delta HZ. For the EY component, we have delta HX and delta HC. And then finally for the EZ component, we have delta HX and delta HY. Now, there are a few other things that are important for these kind of implementations besides the basic update equations, which form the core of what we're doing. One is we have to have some way for fields to be created in the first place, right? So of course, we can assume that all the initial conditions are zero, but we must have some way to start the fields off. Now, one way, of course, that's the most obvious is a so-called hard source, where we just directly specify the field to follow a certain form. So this is basically an example of what we could write down. And then we, of course, have to discretize this on the lattice. And so this is an analytical equation, but it's implemented as like a whole bunch of discrete points with different EZ values. Now, unfortunately, like there can be some stability challenges with that. So although it's easy to write the code for that, it doesn't always work as well when you run the simulation. So oftentimes it's more accurate and also more physically reasonable to specify a current. And then the idea is that the current itself gives rise to the fields. And so, of course, if you go back to look at Ampere's law, you can see that there's a natural place to introduce currents, and that those currents will basically create both E fields and then eventually H fields as well. So it kind of gives rise to the optical propagation that we care about, or even like radio frequency propagation, just depending on the frequency of the oscillation, right? And so always with the current sources, the most important thing is going to be, what is this omega, the frequency that you're operating? And of course, it depends on your lattice discretization, but you need to choose the frequency that's appropriate for your problem and your lattice. You can't, for example, go above the Nyquist limit. And in particular, what that means is the frequency can't oscillate more than half a period per time step, right? So another way to think about it is that Some frequencies are going to be so fast you won't even be able to capture them with a finite delta T. And so then you'd either have to decrease delta T or decrease your omega, depending on what's more appropriate for your problem. And of course, you can go to very low frequencies as well, but then you kind of have almost opposite problem, which is that it's so slow and takes so many time steps, you might not have the patience to wait for it. So there's always kind of a balancing act there. Now, another thing that's going to be very important after you've created the fields is actually like the losses of the fields. And so, of course, most materials will have losses. And there are many models that have been explored to implement losses. And so here's just a few examples. One is constant conductivity. So this would be most appropriate for a metal, where you basically say the metal is subject to Ohm's law. And so that can be implemented as an extra term in Ampere's law with Maxwell's correction. And then second, another approach is the so-called Drude or Drude-Lorentz model. And this can be more accurate, actually, for a lot of materials, especially if you have a broad range of frequencies that you're considering. And Drude-Lorentz is general enough. It can encompass not just metals, but also dielectrics and other materials. And then there's also a Debye model, which maybe can do some dielectrics as well. Now, all of these models, regardless of the choice, have to obey what's called Kramer's-Kronig relationship. And so it's written out here. So, of course, I don't expect you to memorize it, but you should be aware that if you're choosing like a new loss model, it should be consistent with Kramer's-Kronig. Of course, all of these already are, so there's no problem. And then if you want to actually implement numerically these sort of constant conductivity models, then you can see they actually show up fairly straightforwardly in these propagation equations as basically like a loss term for the E field. So the E field almost directly is decaying from the constant conductivity, but then you also have an attenuation of the impact of the changes in H on the E fields. And similarly, of course, you can implement magnetic conductivity. And again, of course, I said before, this is not physically real thing, but it's a computational trick for regions outside of your area of interest to help with the absorption. And so this can actually attenuate the H fields as well. So you can get E and H field attenuation when you want to basically dispose of the fields. In the next lecture, I'll talk about more details about implementation in FDTD.